Hi, we're in November 2011, and this is a series of clips for my algorithms class. We're talking about dynamic programming. This first example is called weighted interval scheduling, and it is an example described in our textbook that we're using this term by Kleinberg and Tardos. The idea, the problem of is that given a set of intervals that may overlap, and each interval has a value assigned to it, find the set of non-overlapping intervals that has maximum weight. So I don't have any weights explicitly assigned on. Well, let's call these circled numbered weights right here for the sake of argument right here. So the problem is then in this set of intervals, where I have a start time and an end time for each interval and a weight for each interval, what is the set of weights, what is the set of intervals that will maximize the total weight that you get? So for example, if I were to choose interval 8 here, the only other non-overlapping interval that I could look at is this 1. So one possibility would be to have my set of intervals be 1 and 8. Another possibility would be to have a set of intervals, for example, just going down here and looking at non-overlapping, 1, 3, and let's say 6. So that's interval 1 plus 3 is 4 plus 6 is 10, which is better than my 8 plus 1. So the problem is to find the set of intervals that maximize weights, and there is no overlapping on the intervals. Okay, so in order to solve this problem, I want to talk about this problem first to give you perspective on how to go about designing a dynamic programming solution. So the first step we're going to do to get a handle on consistent behavior, understanding the behavior of sets of intervals, is to first sort the intervals by non-decreasing finish time. This set of intervals right here has already been sorted that way. So each interval has a start and a finish, and we can see going up down here that the finish times are non-decreasing. Okay, the next thing to do is for each interval, find the interval that does not overlap our j, so that that interval that we find, the p of j, ends before j begins. So for example, for this interval 3 right here, I'm looking for an interval that occurs before this. So I've got 1 and 2 both finish. So in terms of the sorted list, I've got 1 and 2 both precede 3. And of that set, there is an interval 1 that ends before the interval 3 begins. Okay. If I look here at the 6, then the intervals that precede the 6 are 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, like so. To identify the P of 6, can't be 5, can't be 4, because that ends before 6 begins. However, 3 ends before 6 begins, so my P of 6 is 3. My 2 also ends before 6 begins, and so does my 1. So I choose the rightmost interval that ends before my 6 begins. So let me just write down what my solutions are so that you can see those being developed. So I have sorted my intervals like so. So I have 1 through 8. Okay, there is no interval that ends before 1 begins. So I write down 0 for that. Again, there is no interval that ends before 2 begins, so that's 0. For 3, interval 1 ends before 3 begins, so that's 1. And 4, interval 2 ends before 4 begins, so there'll be a 2 for that one. 5, 4 ends before 5 begins. 6, can't be 5, 4, 3. 3 ends before 6 begins. For 7, let's see, that looks like that's interval 1. And for 8, there's where 8 begins, like so. So that'll be interval 1. Okay, so for every interval, these are sorted by finish times. I have my corresponding P of that interval. Okay, now the approach to finding a recursive solution to this problem, which we can then use to ramp over to a dynamic programming solution, is to look for the sub-problems that I can solve. And the way to look at this is to regard this sorted set of intervals right here, sorted by finish time, and look at the very last interval right here. Okay. Now this last interval could be included into our problem. And for simplicity, again, the weights are the same thing as the numbers on the interval. This thing right here could be included as a solution to our problem. So it could be that this is the answer we're going to get if we look at all these intervals. However, if this interval will be included, then I get to include those intervals which are a solution to the problem for P of 8. So in other words, right here, if I'm going to include 8, then I can find I can add to 8 the solution of the problems that are in my P of P of J, right? So for example, in that case, the set of intervals that's in 1 is just this one right here. So that would have 1, and then 8 has a cost of 8 that I'm adding, so that gives me 9. Alternatively, maybe 8 is not in the solution of the optimal set. In that case, the alternative to including 8 is to not include 8. And if I'm not including 8, then I want to look for the solution to the problem that contains interval 7. Okay, and that is my recursive statement right there. So the solution to the problem of computing the optimal weight for the set of intervals that end at J, the recursive step is, either I include that last step, the weight for that last step, the value for that last one, plus the solution to the set of intervals that precede that one. So either I include the weight for 8 plus the optimal solution to the precedes that, which is 1, or the answer is the optimal solution to my set of intervals that doesn't include eight. So it would be the solution to this set of intervals right here. Okay, let's back up a little bit and do it for another example and make sure that we're okay with understanding right here. Suppose the set of intervals I'm looking at is only 1 through 5. Okay, so I'm currently just looking at 1 through 5. Okay, so my recursive step says that either I will have 5 present or not. If 5 is present, then I find the optimal solution for the set of intervals in precedes 5. Precedes 5 is 4. That means I need to find the optimal set in this, the optimal solution to this set of intervals right here, and add that to my 5. So that gives me the weight, the value of 5, plus the optimal solution in the set of intervals that precedes 5. If 5 is not present, then I need to find the optimal solution to the set of intervals that go to 5 minus 1, which is, 1, 2, 3, 4, right here. Okay, so that's my second possibility. Two possibilities, either 5 is included or 5 is not included. Okay, let's do one more. Let's do it for interval number, we just go up to 4. Okay, either 4 will be included or it will not be included. If 4 is included, then I'm going to have the value of 4, which is right here, plus the optimal solution for the set of the interval that precedes 4. What precedes 4 is, we can see it over here, is 2. So that means I'm looking for the optimal solution for this set of intervals. And I will add that weight, right here, precedes 4, to the weight I get for 4. So it's the optimal solution for this set right here, plus the weight I get for 4. So that's one possibility, 4 is present. The other possibility, 4 is not present. In that case, I need to find the optimal solution for the intervals up to 4 minus 1, which is this set right here, 1, 2, and 3. Okay, so in this case, I've got the cost of 4 plus the optimal cost I get from the 1 and 2 set, or optimal cost I get from the 1, 2, 3 set for that one right there.